Okay, the board has returned from executive session. I'd like to make a motion to amend the agenda this evening. I'd like to insert something immediately before the citizens' address to, we'll call it the appointment of a new township administrator. I'll make that motion. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Nay.
Aye. Okay, with that, I'll ask everybody to stand for the pledge and moment of silence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
As we, could you remain standing for the moment of silence, please? And as we think about our intentions this evening, I'd like to ask everybody to think about an employee of our police department who was recently diagnosed with a serious illness. Please keep him in your thoughts and prayers this evening. His family and him really need it, so thank you. Moment of silence. Okay, please be seated. Okay, presentations. We have a swearing-in ceremony this evening.
Good evening.
Good evening. I'd like to introduce the fire department's new assistant fire chief, Chief Will, in order to please come up. Chief Taylor has been with the department for over 20 years. During his tenure, he served not only as a firefighter paramedic, but he started his career here at Colerain Township with the department. He served as a company officer at the rank of captain for a number of years. During his capacity as a company officer, Will proved to be a very effective leader, manager of his people, became very, very respected. He eventually moved on to KR Emergency Medical Services Division. And during his capacity there, Will was very instrumental in improving the services that we provide to the community. We've always provided a top-notch quality emergency medical services to the community, but when Will took over the job, he took it up to the next level. Will proved to be very innovative, work collaboratively with many agencies outside of the fire department, and just really improved the quality of the services that we provide to the community. Last year, Will was recognized as the Firefighter of the Year for his collaborative and innovative work that he's done in the community. This evening, I'd like to swear in new chief, new assistant chief at this time. His wife asked her to come up to that, if she'd come up, and I'll swear Chief Mueller in. Chief, if you'd raise your right hand, please, and repeat after me. I state your name.
I, Will Miller.
Do solemnly swear. That I will uphold the Constitution of the United States of America.
That I will uphold the Constitution of the United States of America.
And the Constitution of the State of Ohio.
And the Constitution of the State of Ohio.
And its bylaws.
And its bylaws.
And that I will faithfully execute.
And that I will faithfully execute.
The duties of Assistant Fire Chief.
The duties of Assistant Fire Chief.
And for Colerain Township.
And for Colerain Township.
Hamilton County.
Hamilton County.
And the State of Ohio.
And the State of Ohio.
To the best of my ability.
To the best of my ability.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Will. I know you're going to do a great job.
Amen.
Thank you.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is here at my request. We've had a couple, not more than a couple, we've had a lot of increasing complaints about odors at Rumkey. And it's been a while since we've engaged the Board of Public Health and Department of Environmental Sciences periodically since the underground reaction started many years ago. We've had periodic updates, and we haven't had one for a while, so I wanted them to address that, and then I also wanted them to address increasing complaints about the masking agent as well. So we've got Brad Miller here tonight, and also Chuck DeJockiner. And Michael, thank you for coming as well. And the way we're going to work this, they're going to do their presentation, and if anybody has any questions tonight, I would ask you to do it in the course of your citizen's address. They're going to jot down all the questions, and then we're just going to answer them all at once and try to do it as expeditiously as we can. So go ahead.
Thank you for inviting us here tonight. We're going to provide an update on Rumkey. If you go ahead and go to the first slide. What I first like to cover is the subsurface incident at Rumkey. Just to kind of, I know Chief Cook gave an update last month on some of this, so some of us may be repetitive, but I want to kind of go through some of the events. On August 2009, there were elevated temperatures detected in the northern end of the landfill. And then on March 18, 2010, Ohio EPA issued director's findings and orders to the Rumkey Sanitary Landfill to address those violations. It identified 69 acres in the northern end of the landfill as the affected area. The orders also created Team Rumkey, which we'll talk about in just a minute. And then also the orders outlined 26 activities that had to be completed. The activities requiring the findings and orders were based on Ohio EPA's experience at Ohio up in the northern portion of the state, up in the Canton area. 2 years prior to this, they had elevated temperatures also. So Ohio EPA had already kind of worked through this process and developed findings and orders and, action items that need to be taken. So that was kind of used for the model in this situation. And then on March 27, 2012, Ohio EPA issued another set of findings and orders to Rumkey, which had additional requirements, including adding more odor control blankets. We saw an increase in complaints in 2011-2012, so that was why the director issued additional findings and orders requiring the odor control blanket to be expanded in the northern end of the landfill, and also some other steps we'll talk about. Then the final findings order stated Rumkey had failed to strictly control odors at the facility in violation of this Ohio Administrative Code rule citation. And this is actually a solid waste regulation that identifies nuisances, and Rumkey was identified as a nuisance in those findings and orders. The newest violations were addressed in the 2012 orders, and then these final findings and orders are still in effect at this time. So once Rumkey completes all the activities and everything goes back to a more like a steady state, they can apply to Ohio EPA and have the findings and orders rescinded or terminated at that point. At this point, all the findings and orders are still in effect at this time. Team Rumkey. I mentioned that Team Rumkey, these orders formed Team Rumkey in the beginning back in 2010. Ohio EPA is the lead agency in Team Rumkey. It's also made up of US EPA, Hamilton County Public Health, Southwest Ohio Air Quality Agency, Colerain Township, and then Rumkey and their consultants with GSF, Montauk Energy. They actually operate the gas control, it's not the gas collection system, but they actually operate the gas recovery plants there at the facility. So that is what, that was Team Rumkey was made up of, and it was trying to be inclusive of all the agencies that were either impacted or had in regulations to address these situations. As part of the findings and orders, there were action items or activities, 26 of them that Rumkey had to follow or had to do action on. The first one was profiling the waste. What they wanted to try to do was try to determine if they could figure out what caused this reaction, so Rumkey had to go back through and look at the waste that was placed in this area. The Northern Ohio landfill that I mentioned up in the Canton area, they actually found that they had accepted aluminum waste that reacted with the water to create the elevated temperatures and led to the beginning of the reaction. In this case, there was no waste that could be actually fingerprinted that actually led to the reaction. US EPA even came in and took samples and took them to their lab in Cincinnati, and it was a pilot scale lab, and tried to recreate to see if they could make this reaction occur in the lab setting, and weren't able to based on the samples of different material from that area of the landfill. Rumkey also was required to measure the volume of leachate. Leachate is the water that comes from the landfill. What happens in these reactions is you see an increase in leachate and can kind of overwhelm their system at times, so they had to monitor and watch that amount of leachate, measure that amount of leachate coming from that northern end of the landfill. They had to evaluate the slope stability. What they had to install were what they call buttresses at the toe of the slope in a couple of the areas, because they did see some movement in the landfill, and those buttresses were successful in keeping the movement of the landfill down and minimizing it. They also had to add multiple borings and trenches to collect an increase in gas. These reactions lead to an increase in gas from that portion of the landfill, so they had to install a lot more borings and wells to actually collect that gas from this area. That gas actually goes to a flare on site, and they burn the gas. The gas from the other portions of the landfill actually go to a gas plant where they actually recover the gas. They also had to create a health and safety plan, provide for emergency response training, and then continue to implement their odor control and response program as part of those findings and orders. They also had to create a contingency plan for an isolation break if it was needed. At this time, there has not been the need for an isolation break, but we still monitor that situation in case they do have to install an isolation break in the portion of the landfill so it does not go into the southern portion of the landfill. They also have to prepare progress reports. We initially had monthly reports and monthly meetings. We're now at a quarterly basis, so Rumpke creates a quarterly report, and then those reports are discussed by Team Rumpke either in a conference call or an actual meeting setting. And then these final findings and orders are all meant to bring our mechanisms to return the landfill to compliance. So that's the purpose of the findings and orders that Ohio EPA issued in 2010 and also in 2012. Just to provide a real brief update on the affected area, the temperatures have remained fairly constant in that northern end, so we still see elevated temperatures. The landfill I mentioned in northern Ohio, they still have, it started about 2 years prior to the Rumpke reaction. They're still seeing elevated temperatures up there, so it's not unusual still to see the elevated temperatures. We have seen a reduction in the amount of settlement over the past year, and we also see less gas being generated in that affected area. So that is an indication that reaction is slowing down. So, as I mentioned, the findings and orders required an odor control plan. As part of the plan, the Rumpke uses an odor control deodorizing system. The material which they spray is actually over 99% water. It's 99.5% water and about 0.5% of these odor control material. Okay, next slide. We did just recently, we had Ohio EPA back in 2013, Ohio EPA, we had a public hearing, I think it was 2012 or 13, we had actually a public hearing here on the odor control system. They actually increased the amount of material they were using. They had to go through a public hearing. We had Ohio EPA at that time, their toxicologists actually review the material safety data sheets. Rumpke has changed some of those odor control materials. So just recently we had sent those back to the Ohio EPA's toxicologists. And I've got the statement here that he provided to us based on his review of the information. I'll go ahead and read it real quick, but it says, using the information provided to Ohio EPA, we observed nothing in the information that would give cause for potential health effects when used in the manner prescribed in the permit. No US EPA or Ohio EPA or toxics permitting thresholds are exceeded by the compound's formulation. Persons believed to be experiencing any irritation caused by the compound's use should contact their local healthcare physician or healthcare provider. So that's the statement he's provided based on his review of the information. Air monitoring, our agency does air monitoring. We've been doing air monitoring since back in 2009, actually, when this first started. We have what we call a loop monitoring, which is 18 points around the landfill. We monitor for methane, total volatile organic compounds, hydrogen sulfide, carbon monoxide, and also the lower explosive limit. We also, back in 2010, operated a fixed air toxic site for 6 months near Bank and Hughes. We've collected various air toxic canister samples, and we've collected two samples this year. We saw an increase in complaints in 2015, so we collected a sample in early 2016, and we also collected a canister sample just about 3 or 4 weeks ago. Based on all the air monitoring data, next slide. Ohio EPA's toxicologists, again, have reviewed all the monitoring data, and they provided the following statement. Based on an ongoing review of the air emission data collected to date, there is no immediate short-term or long-term health threat from the contaminants being measured. So, again, they've reviewed all that previous data we've collected and the most recent data, and that's the statement they've provided to us from Ohio EPA. Okay, right now I'm going to turn this over to Chuck from the Hamilton County Public Health. He's going to talk a little bit more about odor complaint and odor response.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I got the short straw odor. In the interest of providing better customer service to the citizens of Colerain Township, in 2007, We formed a work group to look at odor and look at the response to odor. Representing Colerain Township at the time was David Fogelsong, if you remember. And since Jim Rowan has taken his place, along with Southwest Ohio Air Quality Agency and Rumpke, we've met periodically to review the complaints that have been received, the process that we use to respond to the complaints, and to address them. With reaction and new challenges that have that it has created, we've added two new partners, Ohio EPA and US EPA. The response work group elected to utilize Southwest Ohio Air Quality Agency's existing hotline. They had a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week hotline to take in the complaints. They are then dispatched to Public Health and Rumpke for investigation. We are all using the same forms, the same terms to document findings from the investigations, and those findings are shared with each other. Rumpke is generally the first responder on the evenings and then the weekends. They have staff on duty. But every complaint is investigated independently by Public Health. Believe it or not, Rumpke does document off-site odors. They've proven themselves to be a reliable, credible data collector for us. At this point, though, we only include our findings in a periodic review of that data. That information is posted to our website. We issue an annual report. That's been the frequency as of late. Review of this data, next slide, please, has indicated a high number of complaints. In 2011, to be exact, we had 566 complaints. That's a lot by any standard. This was in the early stages of the reaction. Methods of control were under development. At times, the reaction had gotten in front of the efforts to contain the odorous effect. Since that time, we have seen much improved conditions and an overall downward trend in the complaints and occurrence of off-site odor in general. In addition to complaint response, and similar to the air monitoring that Brad's group is doing, we conduct odor surveillance several times a week, where we drive a similar loop around the landfill. Some weeks that puts us there every day, either responding to a complaint or doing a non-complaint initiated surveillance loop. That loop is based on where we've received complaints in the past. We're trying to be systematic about our approach to this. Over the summer months, the predominant odor is garbage. That's to be expected. This is common at many waste facilities. When garbage sits in people's backyards for a week or at restaurants for a week in the dumpster, when it gets to the landfill, it's pretty ripe, and it's hard to manage. So summer, we generally see working face odors. Next slide, please. On site, there are actions that Rumpke must take to reduce odors. To collect this especially odorous gas from the reaction area, the north end, borings and surface trenches have been installed with vacuum drawing gas out and then routing that to a flare where it's incinerated. The odor control blanket, or OCB as it's referred to, covers approximately 56 acres, with 49 acres of that being recovered with a new and improved blanket. This is a technology that uses a film that's similar to what's in food packaging to prevent oxidation of fruit and ripening. It's called EVOH. It's ethyl vinyl alcohol, and it's sandwiched between two plastic layers. It's proven very effective for the areas that have been subjected to higher temperatures, and it's prevented breakthrough of the odors. We've seen much improved odor on site at the facility. As the waste settles and the blanket is subjected to temperatures, changes there is damage that needs to be addressed. So continual repair of tears and leaks from the odor control blanket or any perforations for any of the collection pipes that are part of that blanket. They all need to be adjusted periodically as there's ebb and flow. At the working face, to address garbage odors, the facility is expected to minimize the size of the working face to accommodate incoming waste volumes. This is a busy landfill. They take in average 8,000 tons a day. That's a lot. It's the far as waste receipts, it's the largest in Ohio. They use a combination of soil and alternate daily covers to prevent odor escape between busy times. They are a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week facility. Particularly odorous loads are to be managed to reduce odor by quickly incorporating them into the waste mass and quickly covering them. In addition to a perimeter odor control system, portable odor units are brought to areas where excavations into placed waste must be made. The odor control system is delicate balance, as some citizens have expressed a displeasure of its odor. We do encourage them to use that sparingly. All three of our agencies have worked on this tirelessly, and we continue to do so. We're trying with the operator to reduce the impact to the community. And at this time, all three of us were available to answer any questions.
Okay. I appreciate your time this evening, and thank you for sticking around so we can field questions from residents as they arise. So thank you. That was helpful. Next item will be the item that we modified the agenda for. So last Thursday, the board received the resignation of Jim Rowan as our administrator. And so the board met an executive session that evening to talk about what our next steps are. And we obviously find ourselves in a very unique situation now. Our assistant administrator, who had been here for 20 years, just left to take the job in Greed Township. Now Mr. Rowan's leaving, and you would say, well, gee, is there any talent left? And I would say there is. And there's an individual in our organization who has consistently distinguished himself throughout his career here in Colerain Township. He grew up here, went to school here, started out as a patrol cop, and he's taken on increasingly more and more responsibility, culminating in a few years ago when we promoted him to public safety director to supervise both police and fire. He's done an exemplary job, and I think he has all the attributes that you want in a leader of your organization. And so I'm going to make a motion this evening to appoint Dan Malloy as the next administrator of Colerain Township. The resolution approving employment agreement of Township Administrator Daniel Malloy is the resolution, and I'll make that motion. I don't think I'm required to. Mr. Barbier, do you disagree?
Read the entire resolution? No, he's not required to do that. Just the title.
And I would ask you, next time you have something to say, we'll save it for citizens' address. We're not doing shout-outs. Okay. So that's the motion. Is there a second?
Before we vote on it, let me just say that, you know, when we're looking for a CEO, there's certain traits that I consider important. You know, you look for somebody with good character. Dan exemplifies that. He's been great ever since he's been public safety director. He's a strong, proven leader within the organization. When you also look for a CEO, you're looking for somebody who's committed. Dan's displayed his commitment to Colerain Township. He's a lifelong resident here. He certainly does what's best for this township, and I believe he'll continue to do that. I also look for somebody who's competent. Dan is clearly competent as a leader. He's a forward thinker. An easy example of this is the QRT that's in place right now in Colerain Township. You know, we're getting national recognition right now for the QRT and their efforts to fight the heroin epidemic. And under Dan's leadership, our police and fire are at the top in this nation. So I think that the choice is obvious for me that Dan would make the best administrator for the township at this time.
Before voting, is there any interest in backfilling Dan's position?
I do not have an interest, and I think that's a Dan would agree with that, that that's a position that we no longer need in light of his subject matter expertise and domain knowledge of the public sector side of our township. I think, and that's obviously one of my main motivations for, I think, picking Dan for this role, is because if you think about your budget and what your mission is according to town of a local government, public safety consumes over two-thirds of our budget. The major role of your local government is to keep people safe, and Dan's a rock star in that area. We just brought back Jeff Mills to shore up the economic development and zoning side, so I think that's a box that's checked as well. So, I personally don't have any interest in backfilling the public safety role, and that's obviously, you know, over $100,000 in savings that we could capture and, you know, turn into other uses.
In regards to that, I think it just goes to speak as to the job that Dan's accomplished. in making our police and fire a true one culture and a team. You know, currently the way that our police and fire are, they are working together, they're sharing resources, and, you know, due to the current climate of our police and fire and with the chiefs in place, I'd feel confident that we would not need to backfill that position at this time.
The feedback I received from residents was fairly overwhelming. If the position didn't need to be backfilled, then why was it a job to begin with? A very expensive one at that. So that's my thoughts on that.
Okay. Sam, would you like to address the public safety role, director role, and some of the changes that you brought in and the moving of the needle that we've seen in the culture since you've taken over?
Thank you. The creation of the position of public safety director was to facilitate a one culture organization between police and fire. It was to generate innovation, to facilitate cooperation and drive the needle. And we realized in 21st century that the work can't be done in silos. That's been the mission of this organization for the last 5 years. And we worked really hard through the Chief Cook, Chief Smith prior to him, Chief Denny, to facilitate a partnership. And there was a lot of change. There was change in organizational structure. Organizational reviews were conducted for the fire department. There was a drive towards accreditation. That was a mission that we believe in based on our accreditation process for the police department. Professionalize and conduct ourselves as the best servant we possibly can for the township. And I agree with you that there's no need to replace this position. We have a very good working relationship. The things that are done sitting together with those two guys and the other chiefs, I believe it is second to none. But the position was necessary in 2013. It's no longer necessary in 16.
You guys are all going to still work together anyway.
Absolutely. You know, the team's not going to stop working. I'm still going to maintain that portion of the job. It's important, but it's not necessarily you have to single somebody out. But the job was necessary. I totally disagree with anybody that believes that wasn't necessary in 2013. If they were here, they would know better. But it's easy to criticize from the outside.
Okay. Any other thoughts? Okay. Is there a second to the motion?
I'll second the motion.
Mr. Denise?
Aye.
Mr. Inskill?
Let me give you a couple more thoughts here. The resolution was sent out last second this afternoon. The board has a history of making quick, cynical, and unenforceable resolutions, but this one was just far more important. Hiring the most important position in the township without doing a single interview, in my opinion, is not responsible government. With that being said, Dan does have some great qualities that we can all appreciate, and I can relate with myself. We have both turned down great opportunities to stay here in Colerain. He's been here his whole life and certainly more invested in our community than his predecessor. And Dan and I also worked our way up. Those are great qualities. I do think we can learn from Green Township's recent hiring process, but someone that may not have applied for that position, for the position there, maybe would have applied here. It's not exactly apples to apples. I talked to our law director, and it's not necessarily that I'm against Dan's hiring. I just needed to do interviews to be 100% confident that I'm making the right choice for our residents, and I wasn't afforded that. So for that reason, my vote is to abstain.
Aye. So I would remind everybody that once again, the board got an executive session last Thursday and had an extensive conversation about this. We discussed at length Dan's qualifications. We find ourselves in a unique situation too, because we know who the top candidates were for the green job, and the person who eventually got it was our assistant administrator. There was also a recent search for a Fairfield Township administrator. So you had the opportunity to compare and contrast a lot of these top candidates with Dan and his qualities and strengths, and be able to make a sound judgment on who the best person is. I think I've had the benefit of working with this guy for 11 years. Mike hasn't had as long a time, but he's highly respected both within this building and in the community, and then in the totality of the situation with his intimate domain knowledge of Colerain Township and his experience. I think it's very important to get behind him from the beginning. We just had a very contentious period here between Mr. Insko and Mr. Rowan. I would argue Mr. Insko has very little professional qualifications or experience, yet he criticizes Mr. Rowley incessantly and made it a very difficult working environment. So I just hope that this organization can hit the ground running with Dan and be professional and be supportive and be one team. Because as Lee Lincoln said, a house divided against itself cannot stand. And so it raises the question, I think, Mr. Insko, what are the qualifications that you think are necessary in a good CEO and a good administrator? Do you know what the term core competency means at all? What are the competencies and traits and characters that you think a person needs to lead an organization? I'm just curious.
A lot of them are the opposite of what you're exhibiting right now. When you hired Rohan, you claimed that you had saved a fortune on headhunters and subsequently splurged on the township credit card. Once again, there are no headhunters involved in finding Dan, so I would request that you refrain from splurging on the township credit card. That's all I have to say on that. I wish you the best, Dan.
Now, that was interesting. It really wasn't a good discussion of the characters and qualities that you think are necessary in a CEO.
You made it clear that you're already hiring
him. If Dan doesn't have him, tell us what is necessary then.
I'm not saying Dan doesn't. I haven't interviewed him.
I'm trying.
It's rare in life where you hire employees without interviewing. Jeff was a special situation. Jeff Mills. That was a special situation. But I haven't had a chance to interview Dan. I just went through and told you some of the great qualities he has. I'd like to hear more about him.
Well, hopefully you'll take the time to forge a relationship with him, unlike what you did with Rowan.
I've known him for 18 years.
Good. Hopefully we can all be a successful organization going forward.
Amen.
And unite behind Dan and show him the support that he needs to be successful. I know I do. Congratulations. And I want to also extend my thanks and gratitude to Mr. Rowan for his 4.5 years of service and wish him the best of luck in his future endeavors. Any last comments before we move on? Okay. Let's see. Let's want to do that for the administrative reports. Okay, we're going to go into citizens' address now. Keith Miller is the first one up.
Rumpke's chemical is going to be my problem and always going to be. I got four chemicals, they all four, combustible or flammable. You tell me not bad for me. How many people had burning eyes when they went home from the 9/11 memorial? My eyes burned for 6 hours. What was that? Tell me what caused that. 6 hours, my eyes burned. Four chemicals right here, all four flammable or combustible. And they tell them they're not doing no harm to us? I got to question that alone. So, you know, all four of them, flammable or combustible. And as for the meeting, I hear a meeting, and I talked to the Chicago office. I made my call to Chicago, and I asked about that meeting, which the public was not invited to. And the way I felt, anybody called an odor claim should have been invited to this meeting. And nobody is. There was no minutes kept at this meeting. So actually, the meeting almost didn't even exist, if you know what I'm saying, you know. There's no minutes kept, and the public's not allowed. Did a meeting actually exist? So, you know, that's all I got to say. I just want to question what's really going on around this township. Thank you all.
Thank you. Lou Schindler.
Thank you. I'm here representing Hamilton County Farm Bureau, and the question I have, I don't know if you can answer it, but maybe you can direct us. Our Farm Bureau board and its members are cautiously questioning what's happening on East Miami Road with the ranch farm. Is there any answers you can give us there?
Okay.
I just recently found out about this. I'm curious myself. I'm very interested.
Yeah, the ranch property, not to the extent of Rumpke, was a hot button issue that we had been following and got periodic updates on. Admittedly, we haven't had one in a while. Where do we stand with race property?
Well, the court has issued an order ordering the races to clear the debris and the steel from their property. The township has repeatedly gone before the court in order to enforce that order. And there is a hearing coming up on October 6th, at which we hope to get this at least close to being accomplished.
Well, when we're talking about removing the debris, I've been seeing agricultural equipment being removed as debris there. Is this common practice?
I don't understand what you're saying. We are trying to get them to comply with the zoning resolution. They're not in compliance because there's a lot of steel and other things on the property that are not supposed to be there, and it's up to them to clear that from the property. Now, if they have equipment on the property that they want to move, regardless of whether that's in violation of the zoning resolution, they can certainly do that.
Is this property zone agriculture?
Yeah, I'm not sure off the top of my head.
I know you, right now pays the CAUV tax rate, which would consider it to be current agricultural use. And what I'm seeing going on right now as an agricultural professional is they're wasting hay fields. That's one thing. The process is trashing the hay fields, which will be compacted, debris dropped on it. And I really question the authority we have to take the non-debris material there. There's actually...
We're not taking anything. The court has ordered them to take items on the property that are in violation of the zoning resolution from the property. That's what's going on.
The zoning resolution now, is it, if it's zoned agriculture, would it not be able to keep agriculture equipment?
Well, I don't want to debate with you the lawsuit. I mean, we already have a judgment from the court. All those issues were considered by the judge. The Racious had an attorney, a very good attorney. The judge has ruled as to what needs to be removed from the property, and that's being done. So I don't think it's appropriate here in this public setting to argue the merits of the litigation in a case that's currently ongoing in which the judge has already issued an order.
When would be a good time to do that?
After the case is completely over, but I'm not going to talk about it during the litigation.
I understand. What I'm asking the township is, there's three generations of Rash family that's been on that farm there. They were here before any agriculture or before any zoning has ever been established here in Colerain Township. It's the man's livelihood is agriculture there. And obviously he operates a scrap business. But what I've seen leaving the property is not necessarily just the scrap that's leaving. We're taking agricultural equipment, whether it might be an old tractor or a new tractor that might not be running. Those are questions that I guess, as a Farm Bureau president, we as a Farm Bureau are required to ask what's going on there. So what's the best time to discuss that with the township, maybe outside the city?
I would say so offline, right? I think Mr. Barbier is the council.
I cannot discuss with you in a public forum.
Issues. When can we do it offline?
Well, I can talk to you about this in more detail over the telephone, or if you want to come to my office, I'll do that. But I can't discuss in a public forum a case that's currently ongoing. And in fact, the judge, as I said, has considered all those issues and has issued her order. So
I guess I'm still questioning it, but we'll get together afterwards.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Schindler.
Thank you.
Kathy Moore.
Good evening. It's been a while. I'd like to welcome Mr. Insko after 9 months, since nobody else did. I have a couple of questions. I saw on the agenda where the fire department's going to hire a mechanic.
A what?
A mechanic.
All right. Okay.
Okay. Will that mechanic be paid totally out of the fire department, even though they're working on other department cars?
That's a good question.
You don't know?
I hadn't thought about it.
I'm asking you. You're the president of the board.
I will give you my opinion. I hadn't thought about which fund he was going to be paid out of. If he is being, if he's working on both police and fire vehicles, then I think it should be allocated in some regard.
Oh, okay. Well, that's interesting. Did we renew the contract with Waycross?
We did not.
You did not. So what? There will be no more?
They were going to an in-house video system. Okay. The meetings will be posted to the website where people can access it at their leisure.
And when will that begin?
The conversion, I think, is in another 2 months.
November.
November. Okay.
Okay. And that'll be totally done by somebody here and in-house?
Yeah. So Rob Shepard has been leading the effort internally, and I suspect we might have to work with, you know, Cincinnati Bell or somebody, you know.
But
her point, are we going to have to engage any consultants or anything to assist? Okay, so it'll be all internal.
And so it'll be the total meeting, no editing or
anything? Already passed a resolution mandating that it's gavel to gavel and there's no editing legally possible. So if we try to interfere and get something omitted, we're violating our own resolution.
Okay. About resolutions, you don't read the resolutions. However, on the resolution, you put that the board by majority vote hereby dispenses with the requirement that this resolution be read on two separate days. You don't read it at all. And you've gone from one meeting down, or two meetings a month down to one meeting. People have an opportunity to come. You don't want to read the resolution. Mr. Malloy, I know, was here when every meeting in the former administration, we read every resolution aloud. And I don't know why you won't do that. Even though you're not required, I don't know why you feel you don't want to do that.
Since the information is available for people, it's not a good use of our time. I think there's a larger point here to make, though, too. And this goes back to the days when you were fiscal officer. For so long, when I joined this organization, I've never seen an organization that was more hostile to change than the organization I came into. Thankfully, that's one of the things Mr. Rowan was able to change. We now embrace change, and people are thought leaders, and we don't make up excuses on a daily basis on why not to act.
You think that's transparent to just say, I vote for this resolution?
There's plenty of opportunity to read it if
they wish. For 4.5 years, and you are so far from it. It's ridiculous.
Great. I don't believe there's a lot of chances to read these because this was just put out earlier today.
Yeah, I looked on the website last night for an agenda, and it wasn't even there last night, so you're not very punctual about it. What is the status of the Firefighter 2B program?
Good question.
Mr. Ritter, do you know?
It's basically been discontinued as we speak. I don't know what else we can say.
It's suspended at this point.
Yeah, it's suspended, and we're not doing it anymore.
And what is the status with the pension system?
So we're still determining if there's a liability or not, and that's still pending with the pension board, correct?
Right.
Okay. When are we expecting an update on that?
In April. Sent us an email in July, and advised that they would send a letter.
You know, I don't regret 2B. The 2B program is another example of us trying to do something innovative that would address a manpower shortage as a result of the Affordable Care Act. And we initially received word that this was legal and
by who?
Appropriate.
Who gave you the word that it was legal?
Initially, it was from the pension board, wasn't it?
Yeah. Oh, so you have that? You have that in writing, and they said it's legal, or you don't?
You do not.
They said it was legal, but you don't have anything that says that. And Mr. Ritter, I saw where you recently took a trip to Las Vegas. And why did you make a trip to Las Vegas at the township?
Las Vegas to promote economic development with this township, to meet with developers who already own property here and are thinking about building more. I don't regret it one iota, and if I had to do it all over again, I'd do it again. I hope I go next year, actually, too.
Okay, well, I guess you got invited then by Mr. Rowan. That's why you went?
Correct.
Okay.
On that topic of Vegas, because I'm curious myself, with Dan as our new administrator, how are we going to go forward with choosing who goes to Vegas for this convention? Is it seniority? Was it your turn this year?
$1,400, Mr. Ritter. That would have paid to move the memorial.
Mr. Ritter, 5 minutes is up.
The street.
5 minutes is up, Ms. Moore.
Okay. Well, bye. Mr. Ritter, we're tired of your minutes. Attitude.
Yeah, great. You too. Mike Parsons is next.
Hold on, he makes a valid point. I believe if we're talking, the time should stop, so they should get that additional time back. Is that correct, Larry, or am I wrong?
I actually think we passed a resolution that said the questions were not going to be answered during the public speaking part, so if they ask questions, we shouldn't be answering them.
Yeah. Mike Parsons, are you going to come forward or not?
How you doing, Mike?
All right. Everybody.
Ritter, you're so shifty, you put Gumby to shame. You really.
Chief, I would direct one of your officers to escort Mr. Parsons from the building.
You have cards.
Now.
My neighbor will collect the cards for me. Thank you.
Stephanie Wright.
You know, I need a few more minutes to confess myself. I asked if I could get a pass.
David Ward.
Thank you. My name is David Ward. I'm been a resident in Colerain Township for 27 years, and I live in Miami Trails subdivision off of Old Colerain. First off, I want to thank Steve Rudelshofer, our public services director, for his responsiveness to my emails in providing me with information to better understand the road repair situation in Colerain Township. In addition, I want to thank the Colerain Township Police, Fire Department, and EMS for their outstanding service to the community. I recently had an experience with the Colerain Police Department, who performed a home watch while I was away for an extended period of time. Their service greatly exceeded my expectations, since there were very few days that a police officer did not do a walk around of my home. I commend them for providing this exemplary service during that time. I also believe that Colerain Township parks and recreation facilities are among the finest in the country. Today, I drove around Colerain Township visiting some of the proposed and ongoing road improvement projects. I saw new businesses being constructed and admired the beautiful gateway that we have for Colerain Township at Springdale and Colerain Roads. We've got a wonderful community center and township administration facility right here at 4200 Springdale Road. And as I drove around, I would think that the residents who live on Yellowwood, Edgewood, Woodsong, Thumble Glen are also proud of the road improvement work being completed today in their subdivision. And I'm sure the property owners on Christie Ridge, Acre, Gardenia are anxiously waiting for their road paving and repair to be completed in the near future. There's a lot of pride flowing in Colerain Township, and we all must thank the trustees and the administration for the work they do. Yes, I am also very proud of Colerain Township, and I thank you for your service. But now let me get to the reason for my visit this evening. For many years, the residents of Miami Trail Subdivision have been concerned about the condition of our subdivision streets. Miami Trail Subdivision was established in 1987, so our streets are now approaching 30 years of age. Many of my neighbors have told me that they have verbally contacted Colerain Township about increasingly deteriorating street conditions. From time to time, township crews come to Miami Trail Subdivision and fill the cracks with street tar, do minor patching to the streets, and on very rare occasions, they have dug up the street to make repairs. Curbs are getting repaired with asphalt placed where large chunks of concrete are missing. There's about 42 homes in Miami Trail Subdivision, and according to Steve, he says our streets total about a half a mile. Through the years, the homeowners in Miami Trail paid over $1 million in property taxes to Colerain Township, and we're proud of our homes and community, and many of us have been involved over the years with community activities. We've got residents who are in their 70s and 80s, and we also have a disabled war veteran who is afraid to get his wheelchair near the street. On July 21st, I reached out to Steve via email to bring attention to the conditions of our street. He showed up the next day to observe the conditions. Good job, Steve. I just hope it wasn't your first visit to Miami Trail Subdivision. I expressed my concerns to him, and he agreed to provide me a list of streets that were being repaired in 2016 and 17. He recommended that I get in touch with the Colerain Township trustees and involve them to get them involved to encourage more road repair funding. A month later, I corresponded again with Steve after seeing many elderly neighbors walking for exercise and having to navigate the potholes and chunks of asphalt. This time I copied the three trustees here this evening. On August 23rd, Steve responded that a work order would be prepared that day to make repairs to the potholes. Unfortunately, those potholes still have not been repaired. On September 8th, Greg Yensko invited me to attend this meeting, and I accepted. As I said, my neighbors and I are proud of Colerain Township, but unfortunately, We are not proud of the condition of the streets in Miami Trail subdivision. Our streets and curbs are crumbling. Visitors to our homes are amazed that the roads are in such poor conditions. We are embarrassed to say that our roads are the responsibility of Colerain Township.
That's 5 minutes, sir.
With your permission, I'd like to approach the trustees, and I'd like to give you a little piece
of the roadway. I got a piece for each of you. But this is what we're contending with as far as the road coming apart and having to walk around this. And,
you know, especially for the elderly people within our subdivision. You know, these are what's laying around the streets, the gutters, and they end up in our yards. You know, I understand that you've got many complex issues in Colerain Township, but the question I have is, why is Miami Trail subdivision not getting road repair completed? As I said, we're 30 years old. We have no sidewalks. People have to navigate in the streets and that. And, you know, I did a little riding around. I agree that Christie Ridge is in need of repaving, but honestly,
he's being respectful. Let him speak his piece.
Because people are going to play the double standard card on me then. Oh, you let Mr. Ward talk, okay. I can't talk.
But I mean, if I could just say a couple more words, I'll wrap it up real quick.
Go ahead.
But I think that Christie Ridge looks better today than Miami Trail subdivision did 10 years ago. So, and yet it's still being repaved. You know, I've been reading in the paper continuously of the money's going towards road repair, and I just think that some of that money needs to be spent in Miami Trail subdivision. So with that, I just want to say I do not agree with the streets that Steve provided me that are going to be part of the 2017 repaving project priority list, and they do not include Miami Trails. So I would be interested in what your thoughts are about my comments today.
Best presentation ever. No one's given me a piece of road before. If you come to every meeting with a piece of road, we're going to have to start paving it, right? I totally sympathize with you. You know, I think if I'm not mistaken, if I read that email correctly, you were kind of in limbo where we didn't quite qualify for skip grant funding, but it wasn't. It's a weird position to be in. There's strength in numbers. Keep it up. You know, just keep up your cause. You know, you're obviously very passionate about it. And I appreciate you bringing up the home watch thing, because before I got elected, I had no idea that our officers did that. So hats off to them for that. $1 million in taxes. You took the time to add up all the taxes. You guys. That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
This is a very important moment here right now. This is a textbook example of why I'm against reinstating the summer camp program and the 4th of July fireworks, for that matter. They're very nice programs, but when you've got a Mr. Ward with a crumbling street, how can you rationalize spending scarce resources on discretionary things like that when we've got a gentleman like this who has a crumbling street?
This is the same guy that said it took all three of us to vote for a levy. You know, whether you're for or against it, that's perfectly fine. That's your opinion.
Now, let me say this, Mr. Ward. So we are, you know, prioritizing fixing the roads as a board. We've all agreed on that during our budget planning. Steve can speak as to the rating system that we're using to make the list of streets that will be repaired the rest of this year and next year. I do understand your frustrations. I mean, you drive the road every day. It's where you live. We're looking for additional ways to fund our roads. Steve's been looking at available grants, applying for those grants. In addition to that, there will be additional funding coming into the township when Hughes Road is vacated. That'll be as part of the Rumpke settlement. The board has unanimously indicated our desire to allocate those funds towards the road. So, I mean, I just ask for your patience. I certainly understand your frustration, though.
We tried a Gen Z 2 years ago. That failed.
I agree.
And we tried a levy last March. We tried twice.
But I guess I am questioning the priority system, the rating system that we're using. When our street is crumbling into chunks like this, and I drive a Christie Ridge, and yeah, there's some bad spots in it, there's some, but I don't see any chunks of asphalt.
Mr. Ward, let's try to move on. But I would ask Steve to try to address the prioritization rating system when you do your administrative report, if we could move things along. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your time.
The summer camp had nothing to do with why your road wasn't paved. Maybe with not backfilling Dan's position, that frees up $100,000 a year. Hopefully we can make that happen a little faster now.
And it could be done in phases. Doesn't have to all be done at once.
Thank you. Thank you. Right.
Trigger on the button.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Evening.
I've really been debating over addressing the township again. My husband, I consulted and asked him his opinion on what he thought I should do. He said, Stephanie, it's just not worth your time. I don't feel that way. I do think it's worth my time. I'm just a resident. I feel like that little Bill on Capitol Hill. I'm sure we all remember the cartoon from, you know, rock the vote or whatever, but I do think that residents need to be heard and should be heard. I'm not educated enough to debate with you, nor do I care to. However, I have reached out to people whom I think might be able to get this township back on track. Those include the U.S. Congressman, Steve Shabbat, Hamilton County Auditor, Dusty Rhodes, Ohio Auditor of State, Dave Yost, and Hamilton County Commissioner, Dennis Dieters. I have spoken with the majority of those people personally and await with anticipation their inquiry to my request to look at how Colerain Township is being ran. I am appalled by the demeanor and disrespect amongst yourselves and to your residents. As I stated, I'm a mom. I wouldn't treat the lady at Kroger's, who I don't know, in front of me in line for having more than 15 items the way you treat the residents that come here to these meetings, Mr. Ritter.
Have you ever watched how we're treated?
You, excuse me, 235. My time. Thank you. You pass out these sheets of how things are going to go throughout the meetings. I've reviewed them. I got a lot of time. Nothing goes as planned. There's always a resolution, an amendment. I think you do that intentionally so that people are not aware of what is happening at their township meetings. I don't know what the time period is that this is to be posted on the website prior to the meeting, but this lady said that she checked last night and it wasn't there. You knew that Dan Malloy was your candidate to replace the city administrator prior to this meeting, prior to this sheet being typed up. Why was that not on there?
We have more debates.
Excuse me?
I digress.
It's tough to hold your tongue, isn't it? It's tough for me as well. Dan, I don't know much about you other than from what I see, you seem like a wonderful, committed Colerain resident. I ask you, with the animosity and the questions being raised here this evening about your appointment to the Chief of Police of Colerain Township, to search in your heart, make sure that you're doing the right thing and going about it the right and correct way. Let the people have a say in who we would like to have as our next administrator. Thank you for your time. Residents, thank you for listening.
Thank you. Mr. McVeigh.
Thank you, Jim. I wish you the best of luck on the new job, and I hope you do well. And Dan, I look forward to working with you. I do look forward to it, and I hope you take into account what this lady said. I think you do. I saw your eyes. And I'll pray for you, like I pray for all the trustees. Jeff, I appreciate the fact you asked the health department and EPA to come tonight to talk with us. It's an important issue, and you've heard us to make that request, and they came. And I appreciate what they said. I did say to Brad, I hope that they come back in about 6 months and tell us about how things are going so we don't have such a big gap. They were very good at explaining that the changes have been put in place since the EPA made their, I don't know what to call it, ruling. And those things are in place. Unfortunately, that situation is not fixed. We currently experience about 300, 350 odor complaints per year. We're on track to do that again this year. That's even taking place with the blanket they have in place, okay? So I think what we have here is a situation where the solutions that have been defined by the EPA are not working. That's simply what's not working. So my request is that you contact them and say, you know, what you're doing, although it was a good first step. I mean, it took us from 600 complaints a year down to 300. We usually ran, before the fire started, about 100 complaints per year, mostly driven by garbage. So what we have in place now is a system that gets us to about 350 complaints per year. And we need to take it to the next step. And I think what we need to do is to ask the EPA to draft another plan, you know, if they need to reconstitute another Rumpke team and getting some more outside experts to come in and take a look at what other things we might do to combat the odors. Because there are things that can be done, and there are people who have dealt with these problems, and I'm encouraging the board, okay, because you know how important this is. You hear from other residents about the odors. You know that they have concerns about the perfume. And even though we have MSD sheets that say that from an MSD handling standpoint, there are no issues with some of these perfumes, we don't have broad-scale testing that says that residents long-term are not going to have an impact. So the issue is not behind us, okay? We still have a problem with the fire at Rumpke, and we need a new set of solutions is what I'm saying, that we need to get the team reformulated to say, what can we do now? I'm not taking exception to the work that's gone on. I know people are working to try to improve things, but what they've got is a game plan in place that's not going to get us to zero, and they need to have a game plan in place to get us to zero. So I appreciate the fact that you've asked them to come in tonight, and I appreciate the fact that they all made a presentation. We need to get a new team with these guys included in it so that we don't lose the advantage of their learning. But we need to take this to a point where it's, you know, down to where it was pre-fire. Now, it may be, to Mike's point, you know, a solution can be a simple solution, although it may be expensive, is, you know, available technology of just, you know, filling that thing in. You know, when this landfill needs to close, which will close it someday, it will be capped. Okay, that's what the EPA requires. And if we were to cap this landfill now that's burning, there is a very good chance that the problems that we're experiencing today, most of them would be going away, because it does take away the infusion of oxygen that's feeding the fire. The fire is causing the leachate, so it's all coming in because stuff is leaking in, and the mat that they put on there is kind of has helped that, but it's not the solution. So I appreciate the fact that you've got them here. Let's not wait another year. Let's bring them back in 6 months. Let's encourage the EPA to come up with a new plan. You know, we need a new plan. It's going to take us down to where we were before this fire started. We're willing to work with you, but we need to get some more experts. I appreciate the fact you've come here. Thank you,
gentlemen. Well, March said. Meeting. That be okay, March of 2017? Okay.
Thank you, Rich. That was well said. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Mark Walsh?
I'll just speak on the infrastructure housing.
Okay. Neil Stubbers?
Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening.
I've been a resident of Colerain going on 40 years, and for 39 and a half of those years, trash pickup was a non-issue. I'd take my trash out the night before, Rumpke would pick it up the next morning, pay my bill, and the cycle continued. Beginning last spring, the driver would not pick up a lot of my trash. Since last spring, I have taken more trash in my car to the church dumpster than Rumpke has picked up. I go on to learn that the township has placed themselves between my relationship with a private sector entity, Rumpke Landfill. I don't appreciate that. It worked fine for all those years. Now, with Colerain Township granting Rumpke the monopoly and picking up trash, they are less apt to pick up my trash. The rules have become very stringent. I put this out last night. I walked it back this morning. I'm not taking it home with me. You guys can find a place in the dumpster to please put it, because I'm not touching it again. We did not ask for your guys' intervention into a relationship that has worked fine between the private citizenry and a private enterprise. And I would like you to dissolve the monopoly. I went on to contact some of their competitors, and I was told by the competitors that Colerain Township has granted Rumpke a monopoly in picking up. Therefore, I have no options. And we don't appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay.
Jim Acton.
Mr. Ritter, is there somebody else that wants to speak? Yes, sir. Why don't you go ahead, please?
Charlie S.
Let's buy a little off topic, but I've been here a lot, so with the medical marijuana dispensaries, maybe next year or so getting built. Is this something you guys look forward to doing or just totally away from? Because I've heard of other cities say, hey, it's illegal federally. We're not touching. We're not letting in our cities near school, near anything. That's why, you know, it kind of makes us aware now, so you guys don't jump ahead and say, okay, we're going to make some amendment pass without telling anybody as usual, or somebody, you know, contributes to a campaign.
Thank you. Linda Rothwell.
I only have two things to address tonight. First off, with respects to the three gentlemen, my question for you guys is there any way that the health department could maybe do a survey of the Colerain Township residents to find out how many people are actually experiencing health issues, which could be in some way related to the odors that we smell from Rumpke? It's easy to say that what they use wouldn't cause health problems, but I think when you look at us, if you took a survey of the area and saw just how many people have issues, then maybe somebody could look at it a little different. Now, my other option here to talk about was I learned something in the past week, and that is once you put your garbage out to the curb, it's no longer your garbage. I learned that from our local police department. I had the opportunity last Thursday to actually videotape my garbage guy reading mail out of my garbage. I contacted Rumpke about it, as well as I did speak with, well, I emailed you, and the policeman did come over and look at the video. According to Rumpke, and this is why I wanted to say this on this so that older people can hear it, they have the right to ensure that only our paying customers placing trash at the curb for collection. So that is their response as to why they have the permission basically to read people's mail in the garbage. I don't agree with that. I don't pay them to read my mail. And I definitely don't think it's any other business who resides in my residence. But I guess what I want to get out there is for everyone to shred everything. There's a lot of older people on my street who don't have shredders. I've made everyone on my street aware of the fact, because I did mention to you the last meeting that someone else had came to me and said they were doing it to their mail,
and you asked for pictures, and I couldn't provide them because I wasn't there. Well, I actually have the video of them doing it. So, you know, I don't think Rumpke, with all the identity theft that's going on in the world, I just don't think it's right.
Valid concern.
Yeah, and they just kind of like blew it off, and I think that's wrong. But like she said, you know, they look to see whose mail is in your garbage. Well, if my boyfriend was living with me, if I had one, it's nobody else's business but mine if he lives there.
I agree with you.
And I just, you know, I don't know if there's anything else that can be done.
Make sure you shred your documents.
Well, yeah, and that's what I've been trying to tell everyone else, and I told them, if you don't have a shredder, you can bring it to my house and we can shred it. But, you know, it's just, if he did it to my house and he's done it a couple of other people I know of, it's an ongoing thing, and it just, I just don't think it's right. And I just wanted to put that out there. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If I may add, just for the public's notice, the courts have said you lose all expectation of privacy in your garbage if you put it out on the curb. So frankly, anybody can look through it. So I would definitely agree that you should shred your garbage.
People and I am paying to take my garbage.
But anybody can look through it. That's the law.
I understand. If okay. It had been a normal garbage picker, I probably wouldn't have been able to do anything. But this is a company that you guys
hooked me up with. It's a vendor that you're using, right?
You know, and I don't expect them to stand there and read my mail.
Sure.
You know, the postmaster, I haven't heard back from them because some of the mail that they're actually opening wasn't even opened. It was junk mail. Well, if I took it out of your mailbox and opened it, you know, you can get in trouble for that.
That's a crime.
But because it's at the curb.
Not a crime.
It's not a crime, but I don't think it's right. That's my point.
Mr. Linville?
First of all,
congratulations,
Dan.
Thank you, sir.
Very nice gesture, Mr. Linville.
Man, glad I'm last, or almost. Well, first of all, I got about three things, and it's always about the senior place. Now, I don't know when are you leaving and when are you coming. I don't know which one to talk to about my problem. Of all things, we don't have any drinking water up at the senior place.
Now, we work out. Did I hear that right?
That damn fountain water comes up about that far.
Okay.
And you have to put your mouth on the stem to get the water.
No fun.
So somebody brings them little jugs like you had, little bottles, or they brought a 2-gallon jug in where you push the little button. That we can get water.
Efficient, I agree.
And we work out up there at least 3 times a week. They always say, go get water. We ain't got any water. So it either needs to be adjusted or replaced. And I thank Jim for getting us next year in the budget to get what we need. I thank you for that before you leave. So that's my biggest gripe. Fix the fountain so we seniors can have water. The other thing is, the last time I was here, I got pretty upset with you and you because of the parks. Unfortunately, he is correct not putting a Colerain on the thing, because if Hamilton County puts their parks on there, there's no way that they're both gonna pass. So, unfortunately, he was right. But I want the parks for our kids, and I want the senior place for the seniors. And anytime I find something wrong, you will hear me. You will get me. Okay? Now, on the EPA Rumpke, when they picked up my garbage, I sat out there on Thursday, drinking my coffee, doing nothing. When recycling comes around, who picks up my recycling? City of Cincinnati trucks. Big signs on the trucks. City of Cincinnati. Now, are they stealing it, or are they taking it and giving us credit? I don't know. The drivers won't tell you. But that's one thing about Rumpke. Now, I'm not blaming Rumpke on my wife's death. I think when your time comes, you're going to go, you're going to go. But as far as that date, as far back as I can go, was 2007. We moved here in 1964, a little few years before that. from 65, we start getting those odors. And I think there's hundreds of times when my wife could not sit on the front porch because that wind blew that odor down to our front porch. Whether that was the cause of her death, I will never say. But there is a damn odor up there. And if you want to change houses from June to July, I live by myself, you can live in my house, I'll live in yours, and you can smell that rumpy for 3 months. Won't cost you no rent. But I'm going to swap with you. That's all I got to say about rumpy. And I do owe you apologies. He was right on the parts.
No problem. Thank you, Bill.
I do have a picture of those trucks for you.
Yeah, be good. Steve, real quick, were you jotting notes on the water fountain? You're going to take care of that, I assume. That's what that was. Okay. I think we got that one covered. Okay, Jim Axon.
Good evening.
Jim?
Before I get started here, my condolences to the Rumpke organization about the passing of the Rumpke family. I don't know if you read it in the paper, but I was surprised to read it too. So that's two of the guys that I knew that have passed away. So my condolences to you and the organization. A couple of things I've got before I get into my presentation here, but residents of the Colerain Township, thanks to Chris McKee and his organization over at the school board, both Northwest and Colerain Stadium now have handicapped seating. It's generally at the 35 to 40 yard line towards the west end of the stadium. Colerain Township has a limousine service. If you trust the coach that drives it, and the great van that they have that has squeaky brakes, and he puts it on 10 feet before you stop. But they do have a service that will pick you up. And also, there are 8 handicapped parking spots at Colerain High School. And if I remember right, I think there's 6 at Northwest School District, but they've extended it out towards Pippin Road to make it more accessible for us old people. Dan, congratulations. Glad you got the job. Hope you're transparent to all of us, many of the residents that were said tonight. Again, congratulations. In my religion, this is the year of peace throughout the whole world. Now, it is up to each of us, whether we're watching this on Waycross or sitting in this audience, to become more open to our fellow residents, our elected officials, and all those who work for us in our township. In these ways, may we continue to gain better understanding of our fellow township residents, those that we have elected, and those that are working for us. As a lady said before, it bothers me a great deal to see fighting among the trustees. You know, we're all adults. We all should be able to think positive, not negative all the time. So let's continue. And again, as I say in my religion, the year of peace. I want to thank all of you here in attendance tonight and those watching us on Waycross. May we all have a peaceful rest of the year. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, let's move on to administrative reports.
Jenna.
The count. We did do that. Thanks, Heather. Thank you. We were going to give you the opportunity to address the questions that came up during citizens' address. Thank you again.
Okay, concerning Mr. Miller's request, we did have Ohio EPA's toxicologist look at the safety data sheets for those odor control materials and got that statement. I will check into it to determine if that material is a combustible flammable material as applied. They mix it with 99.5% water, 0.5% material, so we will look into that, and I'll follow up with him. And then in reference to Mr. McVeigh, we will go ahead and Michael Harris will take that, your request, back to Ohio EPA and see what additional measures may be taken to see if something else can be done to, maybe lessen the impact from that north end of the landfill. And Chuck, I'll let you take the last question.
I can check with our agency. We do have an epidemiology division. I can see what their capacity is to do a survey like you're describing.
Yeah, because, it's really, I know it just kind of sounds maybe a little odd, but it's not just humans. I mean, it's like when I addressed the board at the last meeting, I told them, I've lost family members, too, in the last 4 years to cancer. I've put down numerous dogs and cats because of cancer. And I'm just one house out of how many? And there is a lot of people in our community that have either had cancer, battled cancer, died from it. And I just think if they did an overall census, they might be able to say, hey, long-term breathing these chemicals is not helping these people. But unless somebody takes that initiative, we're just going to have to keep suffering the way we do now.
Okay, we hear you.
Thanks, gentlemen. Thank you. Appreciate that. As long as we're on the subject of Rumpke, there's one more thing that was said about the waste district that, we just gave Rumpke the business. There was a competitive bidding process for the waste district, and they were the low bidder. So for the competitors, we just gave them the business. There was a competitive bidding process, and Rumpke was the low bidder. I understand some people, have being against the waste district, but there's multitudes of people out there that are grateful for the free recycling, for the 20% lower bill that they have. And so it goes both ways. I'm sensitive to it, but.
I still believe that next time you should put it to the vote if it gets passed.
If that's legally possible, I would agree with that, actually. Okay. We're going to go to administrative reports now, Ms. LeCount. Okay. Chief?
Thank you. Just on behalf of the police department, I want to thank Mr. Ryan for his support and his assistance with us over the years he's been here. He's been a great supporter of ours, and we appreciate everything he's done for us. We're going to miss him, and good luck to you, sir. And to my friend, Dan Malloy, I want to congratulate him on his appointment. You're not going to find a more honorable, dedicated man than him, and the township's in good hands. So I commend the board on their choice. Thank you.
I also echo Chief Denny's comments there. Mr. Rowan, thank you very much for your support and assistance through your tenure, and as my capacity as chief as well. I wish you the best of luck and congratulations, Director Malloy, to you as well on your new appointment. And lastly, I'd like to thank the community and the people who observed Patriot Day on Sunday, September 11th. There were several services being conducted throughout the community, which all asked of representation from police and fire, and we did our best to represent the services, and I just personally thank those who observed and recognized police and fire for their services, and remember those that that were killed during the attacks on America on September the 11th.
Jim, good luck. You've been a great boss. Thank you for the opportunity to come here. It's a great organization. Dan, congratulations. I know you're going to make a great boss. Give you an update on some of the projects going on in the township. As Mr. Ward mentioned, he drove over behind us in the Yellowwood, Eddystone, Woodsong, Mandrake, Woodchuck, Thimble Glen. All those streets have the new curb put in. Catch basins are reconstructed. Curb ramps are being put in. That's just a sampling of the remaining streets that the contractor has to do. So if anybody is interested to see what their street will end up looking like, those streets have the new curbs in them, waiting on the final asphalt course. Next week, they'll be starting on Kingman and moving into the Royal Heights neighborhood the following week. It's looking like the construction schedule should be wrapping up mid to late October. So continue to remind residents to be patient while the construction process is ongoing. The other project that we had underway over in started today over in the Lake Hills subdivision, the polyfill process began today. They should be finishing that up tomorrow. That is just the first phase. And those streets that were affected were Desert Gold, Lake Valley, Spring Lake, Spring Water, Deer Valley, Deer Lake, and Long Lake. The second phase, which will be the light cape seal phase, that construction process will be a two-phase process and is scheduled to begin mid-October. Maintenance of traffic will be maintained during the first phase. During the second phase, the side streets will have to be closed for a couple hours at a period of time. The contractor or township inspector will be coordinating with the residents on this process, and everything should go smooth with cooperation between all parties. The update on the OPWC skip applications, Township submitted three applications on September 13th. The three applications were, first one was Royal Heights neighborhood, Jackie's, Linus, Royal Heights, Barthas, and Henge. The second application to OPWC was Acre Drive and Gardenia Drive. The limits on Acre Drive are from Banning to Burnside. And the third application was Burnside from Colerain to Memory. As I mentioned on the last report, we have approximately $9.1 million available in grant funding. $12.7 million in loan funding is available. I think we'll be competitive with other townships and municipalities within Hamilton County. The board took strong action to ensure this. One of the steps was allocating a portion of the Rumpke settlement fees to the road program. So this should get us on even ground with everybody else. Regarding the citizen's address, as Mr. Ward said, I've had numerous conversations with him regarding the Miami Trails neighborhood. A work order was made. We prioritized those work orders. We finished up some work over in the Lake Hills subdivision this past week. And as Michael is aware of, there was some work on Challenger Way that we had scheduled as well. I think they were out there this week. You probably seen our guys addressing some pavement issue out on Challenger. And then the next project would be Miami Trails for asphalt work. And just to, there has been no list made yet for the 2017 roadway program. I gave Mr. Ward an example of some recent complaints we've received from residents on other streets. Christie Ridge was one of them. Squirrel's Nest, just to name a few. And I think I've mentioned before, we probably receive 3 to 4 complaints on roads a day.
Steve, I think his point, though, that he wanted addressed was a discussion on the methodology on how you prioritize the streets. So if you could, I know he's not here anymore.
Yeah.
So people understand.
Yeah, we'll look at
one street rise to the top.
There's a pavement condition index that the township utilizes, 100 being the best, 0 being the worst. As I told Mr. Ward, I ran through the list of our 478 streets. A rough estimate would be we probably have between 30 and 50 streets between a 0 and a 5. As you know, next year we're allocating $1.25 million to the road program. I estimated Miami Trails to cost around $300,000 to install new curves and to grind out the surface course of the asphalt, put new surface course. So if you take the $300,000 out of the 1.25, you know, we're talking, you know, roughly 25% of the budget on two streets. What do you do with the other 35 to 50 streets? It's a problem. I will make a work order, make sure the drinking fountain is fixed. That is the first I've heard of it, and I appreciate you bringing that to my attention. Yep, that is the first I've heard of it. And as I tell all the residents, you know, we don't live on your streets. We may go down them. The residents that live on the street obviously know what needs to be fixed and addressed. And I was thank them for letting us know what needs to be done. So thank you.
Real quick.
You did yellow wood the other day, or you know, you're doing it now. I'm just curious, were them little side streets that go to the park only, where maybe a house on this side would park and a house, no traffic goes on it, it just dead ends. Why would you spend thousands of dollars to do that section? It's not, traffic doesn't go on it. It just walks, it's a path to that Colerain Park. I don't know how many of them are in the township, but it just looks like it's a waste of money for doing a payment that no cars go on.
Well, it's funny you said that, because a couple weeks ago, a resident on one of the little spur streets that backs up to the park that we are not doing, I can't think of the name of it, but he came. He came in raising all kinds of cane with me, asking me why I'm not doing it. So, but if it's a part of the street, well, we'll do it. You know, if it's Thimble Glen, we ended up doing the next one down where we weren't doing any improvements. We didn't do anything to that one, and he was pretty upset. So I told him if we do it in the future, the little spur street will be done. And to remind you, They are taxpayers as well, so we don't.
Well, even though cars don't use it, you're.
There are driveways off those side streets.
Right. Okay. Just curious. But we need money to fix them. I just thought it was a waste.
I would agree. I got a call from a resident that asked me to pass this to you and to the road employees. A huge thank you for fixing Challenger Way. That was obviously a bad road. So thank you very much. If you can pass that along. Gratitude there was
it was a busy day for me, so I'm assuming they completed it today. Is that
perfect?
Okay.
Thank you, sir. I like the comments of the other leaders in the organization. Sharon, we appreciate your spending time with us. You know, you came in as the boss, you got the fire hose, you know, and you took it and had to deal with a lot, and we appreciate your commitment to our community and this group. We're better for you being here. just appreciate your friendship. So quickly, and to echo the chief, we had our own 9/11 service on Sunday at the corner. It was very well attended, probably about 100 people. I want to make sure I take a moment to thank someone that I forgot to thank on Sunday was Jennifer Plogger. Jennifer worked with her CFA, her Citizen Fire Academy folks, to make that happen. And I had her written down to make sure I thanked her, and I forgot, because she was pushing and making sure we got our stuff together and helping us get it coordinated, as well as Chaplain Love. Chaplain Love is the police department chaplain, and he facilitated the event for us, and in fact, held his Sunday church service at the corner. So the event was that important that we participate in. It will be an every year event now. It was something that needs to be done, and that day needs to be remembered, and we need to remember those who lost their lives giving themselves. So on a more positive note, September 10th, we had our second annual police and fire community picnic with the Skyline Acres community. Went very well. It was very well attended from the police and fire and the township employees. We again were working on the trust and building relationships within the community. We're still not happy with the folks from the community, but we had a couple very, very good conversations, and we believe those are going to help facilitate some inroads into the Skyline Acres community.
And I think you just may have misspoke. You said we're not happy with the people in the community. It's the attendance.
It's the attendance, I promise. Yes, thank you. No. We're always hoping for everybody, and we know we don't get it. So, but we had really good conversations. And just to follow up, there was a comment or a question raised about a property in the Skyline Acres about being abandoned and vacant. Jenna's staff is already working on it and moving forward to make sure we take care of that property in there. We had a
contact the lady who talked to us about that.
Well, the chief has the information. Now we've got it. We're going to reach out to her and let her know. We had last night another just a conversation race relation event with the YMCA, and it very well attended. We're working with the church groups, church leaders throughout the region to get inroads and meet new people and make connections within our community so we can continue to work on and discuss that relationship that's really, really at the forefront of news and what's going on other places and across the country. We want to be ahead of the curve and be proactive so our community knows who our police and our fire are, and they understand why they work and what they do for a living. So it was very well attended, and we'll begin meeting again on a regular basis. So we're still moving forward. So thank you again.
Just a comment on a few of the statements made tonight. So with regards to the hiring of the mechanic, yes, if the mechanic within the fire department does any work for other departments, there will be billing. If there's any work by the public works department that is done for the police or fire, there will be billing. So there will be an allocation of cost associated with that mechanic's position. I also suspect there will be further investigation on allocating general fund costs, such as our law director's fee, as well as others, to other departments that currently don't pay. And we do have the ability to do that. It's something we have not done, but as we look at allocating cost, it might be time to start to think about allocating some of those other costs to other departments. With regards to the medical marijuana issue, at a meeting or two ago, we passed a moratorium for a year. So we're going to continue to study that issue from a zoning perspective, and we'll report back on that at a future date. I'd like to talk just a minute about transparency. I would challenge those that are here tonight, as well as those that are watching on Waycrest, to maybe Google transparency and see how you define it. Because I would tell you that if you go out on our website and you go back into the document website that stores a number of public records, you will see that prior to 2012 there aren't near as many records posted as there are today. In fact, we participate not only in the checkbook.com, we post board packets most of the times on Friday prior to the meeting, and I'm talking about pretty much the entirety. What happened tonight is an exception. That doesn't happen all the time, but I would commend this team for being transparent and putting things out there. That's something that's never been done before. We could very simply issue an agenda and that's it, but we don't. We publish as much as possible so that the public has the opportunity to read those resolutions prior to getting here. I do recognize that there are some exceptions to that. So I commend the efforts that we make to be transparent. I think some people just struggle with the definition of transparency. On a final note is my resignation, and I would first like to thank those that were responsible for giving me the opportunity, Trustee Ritter, previous Trustee Daters, and Mindy Reinhardt, as well as Heather, the leadership, the elected leadership that gave me the opportunity to come in here and lead. That's not possible without a great team, and we have a great team sitting around here, and I am confident that Dan will have the leadership to continue moving forward. I haven't had the chance to work with you too long, Mike, but I appreciate your passion, and I think you'll bring a lot to the table. There's a couple individuals of particular that aren't here tonight that are of great value to me. That's Emily Randolph, our Director of HR and Accounting, to be able to streamline our HR processes and bring it in under one umbrella has been significant as we've attempted to bring in one culture. Lindsay Helmers, our accounting specialist, has also been instrumental in bringing about greater accountability in what she does and to try to coordinate the efforts from a township perspective. And I'd also like to thank in particular all the employees of the police and fire department. I think that the efforts that they have worked on over the past several years to accept the one culture concept, the cultural challenges that we had. I think it's evidenced by the most recent collective bargaining contracts that we were able to work through, that we start to bring some consistency within the public safety department. I commend Dan and his leadership in his role as public safety director. Yes, I do believe strongly that that position was needed in 2013. Had we not created that position, I don't think we'd be where we are today with the consistency and the working together within police and fire. Why isn't it needed any longer? Because you just promoted the guy that knows all about public safety as your administrator. So you're not losing out on that opportunity to continue to advance that culture. So I would like to thank the men and women of the public safety department for their commitment every day, for the service they give to this township, and I'd like to thank my team once again for everything you've done.
Thanks, Jim.
Thank you.
Trustees report, Mr. Insko.
All right. Thank you all for enduring this meeting. I hope everyone had a happy Labor Day. I want to thank our employees for putting together the September 11th Memorial event at the former quarry in Springdale. There was a really nice piece on the news about it. And I also want to thank Reverend Lisa Arrington for inviting me to Hope Lutheran Church on Blue Rock for their September 11th Memorial service. I'd also like to welcome Jeff back to Colerain when he gets here. I'm confident he'll do great things for our residents. I was told that Chris Coleman was recognized at WEBN's Back the Blue celebration at the fireworks. Colerain's very lucky to have him on our staff as well. Shannon and payroll and benefits reminded me that everyone's to mark their planners since the flu season is almost here. Once again, flu shots will be on site. The Colerain Walgreens will be at the administration building September 21st from 7 to 9 a.m. to administer flu shots. There's no cost as long as you have your Colerain health insurance. September 29th from 11 to 3 is the Business Expo and Job Fair at Northgate Mall if anyone is interested in networking or knows someone looking for work. I appreciate the Chamber of Commerce presenting this event. The Colerain Community Association did an amazing job landscaping the highway ramps. I know former trustee Diana Lynn Relag and a ton of volunteers worked really hard on that, and they all deserve a round of applause for that. Not right now. I had a couple of residents ask when Colerain Recycling Day is, and Dan said it's in September. It's actually September 24th. Steve said that he needs 20 employees, and last I heard he had 13. Is that still the case, Steve, as far as you know?
For which department?
For Colerain Recycling Day. You need it 20?
Last year we had around 13, 15, and past 20 seemed to work.
Okay, so we still need it.
About 7 more if you want.
Perfect. I want to congratulate the Northwest Knights on the dedication of their new football field. They've got a great group of kids. Also, congrats to my alma mater, Colerain, who's off to a great season and just beat my friends at LaSalle. I got a ton of calls after the game in regards to a bomb threat. There were several around the tri-state that day, and I appreciate Chief Mark Denny's quick response to how it was handled. Hindsight's always 20/20 in situations like that, but I just thank God that everything was ended up being okay. If you would like to talk to either of our chiefs, they do a Coffee with the Chiefs program, and the next one is Friday at Tags. A friend of mine's mom owns a restaurant, and they have a dipping sauce that everyone should try. It's great. Jim did a good job. He sent out the dashboard in August, and there were some interesting things in there. I was talking to Chief Denny earlier. Colerain averages like 7 arrests per day, and I mean, you're talking a couple thousand a year. And interestingly enough, only 20% of those or less, by best guess,
is our Colerain Township residents. On fire and EMS, the call times, 80% of the time, under 6 minutes. So I appreciate that. I think the ISO rating reflected that. I want to congratulate Dan. You worked all the way up. I can respect that. And I look forward to seeing what you're capable of doing. So congrats on working all the way up. Addressing Stephanie, she had said she was just a resident. And I can tell you there was a time when I was just the camp counselor. My friend Megan, before she passed away, she had a saying, and she said, the people crazy enough to change the world do. So, you know, you can be whatever you want to be. So, you know, Dan works his way up. Everyone has a story like that. So don't let that hold you back. The media doesn't always do Colerain justice, but I haven't seen a heroin overdose story, and there were lots of them, in the last month that didn't praise our quick response team. They're an incredibly passionate group of people saving lives on a daily basis, so a huge thank you to them. The Creedville Toll Booth project was also in the Inquirer, and I can't thank Chris Henson and her army of volunteers enough as well for making this happen. The Colerain Historical Society's Runner Walk 5K is the last Saturday of this month, which is September 24th. Although the deadline's passed, Heritage Day community basket raffles can be picked up by Chris if you can't deliver them. Last year, she said they made $368 just on basket raffles. A huge thank you goes out to Carol Callahan for her hard work on that. My dance studio in the mall donated a raffle basket, and we also donated one yesterday for the golf outing. I know Jamie Penley worked really hard on the Colerain Township Police and Fire Services Committee for their annual event at Pebble Creek Golf Course yesterday. And congrats to Jeff. I hear you hit a hole-in-one. If anyone ever has a cause or a benefit, I'll be happy to donate, so don't be afraid to ask. I got great feedback about the Bowling for the Brave event benefiting our local veterans at Colerain Bowl. I thank Jeff Niehaus for his hard work last month, but I also need to thank Pat Day, Emily Magley, Mickey Heeg, Kathy Haberlin, Cindy Ryman, Libby Niehaus, Elizabeth Curry, Eric Day, and countless sponsors, donors, and volunteers that make that event work every year. In other bowling news, Andy Demaropoulos from the police department is setting up a bowling league if anybody's interested. Special thanks to Darcy Bradley for saving our movies in the park again. Although summer events are over, there's still free entertainment in the township. I know Dr. Murdoch's annual family skating party is Sunday, October 9th, 6:30 to 8:45 p.m. if anyone's interested. Potbelly Restaurant did a fundraiser tonight. I think we missed the deadline, though, if anybody wants to leave and get something to eat. They've been donating, I believe, 25% of proceeds to the Colerain Historical Society, so we really appreciate their partnership, and good job getting that partnership. Last month, I was excited to announce that a kidney was found for resident Don Henry Langdon, and I'm glad to say she is recovering nicely from the surgery. We have a great employee that's having health issues right now, and if you would, just please send an unspoken prayer request for this person. It would be greatly appreciated. Lastly, I make myself available to any resident, anytime. My job is to reflect your wants and needs. And so don't be afraid to reach out to me anytime. Thank you, guys. Mike?
I'd like to start off just by thanking Jim for his 4.5 years of service. We haven't had much time to work together, but I can tell you it's been truly a pleasure to work with you. And just want to thank you. Wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Dan, congratulations.
Thank you.
Excited for you to be the next administrator and 100% believe that you'll do the job well. And you're the right choice. As to recycling day, I guess with what Mr. Stubbers has left here today that Rumpke wouldn't pick up, I think that might be the first item that I'll drop off there. But in regards to what you can drop off at the recycling day, you can go to Colerain.org and then click on the residence tab. And then under the residence tab, there's a trash and recycling link. And that's where it'll list all the items that you either can or cannot drop off, and for certain items like tires, there might be a nominal fee associated with that. So be sure to check that out before you come up to drop things off, just so that you're aware ahead of time. It's been a busy month in Colerain. You know, if anybody tells you there's nothing to do here, they're lying to you. You know, over the past month, we've had the Taste of Colerain, we've had Germania Oktoberfest, we've had Vinicolette Art and Wine Festival. Did the Skyline Community Cookout. and the 9/11 memorial ceremony. So there's been a lot going on in Colerain. There's a lot of good things happening here. In the next month, we'll have a few more things going on. Like Donna Schwab and Oktoberfest is coming up September 30th to October 2nd. I had an opportunity to participate in the parade with Trustee Ritter and Ms. Harlow, our fiscal officer, and that was a real pleasure to meet people of Germania and participate in the parade as an official, and to have my son there, that really, it was a good time for us. In regards to the 9/11 ceremony, I want to thank everybody that put that together. I know it was hard to get together kind of in the last minute, but it turned out very nice, and it was a great way to just to honor people who lost their lives. I want to especially thank my wife, too. She did a great job singing the national anthem. I got to give her recognition for that. And on a personal note, I definitely want to thank my parents. A happy anniversary. They've been married for 41 years now. So definitely want to wish them a happy anniversary. That's all I got.
Thanks, Mike. Thank you. As for myself, some of this was already mentioned. Actually, most of it was, but I'm going to reiterate it because it's very important. Wanted to thank Dan for putting the ceremony together last Sunday to memorialize 9/11. It was a great ceremony, and you put it together really quickly and really effectively. And thank you again for inviting me to say a few words. It meant the world to me, so thank you. I want to also thank Lisa Arrington from the Hope Lutheran Church for inviting us over on Sunday. They had a ceremony there to recognize public officials. And, you know, we don't do this for the praise or the glory or anything, and it was just a nice gesture that I really appreciated. And it was my first Lutheran ceremony of my life, so that was interesting, too. And then lastly, I'd be remiss if I didn't thank Jim also for his service and partnership over the years, and just reiterate my best wishes for his future endeavors. Okay, let's move on to public hearings on a demolition.
Last month, we requested a public hearing for the demolition of the property at 9832 Dunraven Drive due to a fire that was sustained in June of 2014. It has subsequently been deemed unsafe and a great risk to the neighborhood by the Colerain Township Fire Department. And I do believe that Captain Mark Walsh is here to provide you some more detailed information on the happenings of this property.
Before Captain Walsh testifies, I think we need a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved. Chair will second.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Aye.
Mr. Itzka?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Will anybody who intends to testify at this public hearing please stand and raise your right hand? You solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I was asked by the zoning director to go out and do an inspection on the said property located up there on Dunraven Road, 9832. As indicated, we had a fire that took place on June 18th of 2014. Since that time, the property has been in the same state it has been and has deteriorated over the past couple years. Based on the Ohio Revised Code, Section 506.86.B, the fire department is deeming this property unsafe and unsecured for not just as a nuisance, but also for firefighter safety and public safety, and recommend it to be demoed as is.
Captain Walsh, I note from the file that the there's a photograph and a memo from you dated 5/5/2016. Is that correct?
That's correct. We had one at 5/2016, and we did another one on September 7, 2016 as well.
And on the April 27, 2016 visit, did you reach a conclusion that the property was unsafe and unsecure?
Yes, sir.
And you said you had a subsequent visit?
Oh, yeah, September 7th. We went back and revisited the site. The conditions have not changed, even gotten worse. Based on our observation, we still recommend it that it should be demoed.
And still unsafe and unsecure at that time?
It's secure to the point of some of the basic stuff, but the construction is deteriorating because it is open to the weather and stuff like that, yeah.
Okay. And do you still believe it poses a danger?
In the condition it does, yes.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody else would like to speak at the public hearing? Please do.
I'm Jason Rand. We're the owner of the property. We acquired that for our son, and about a year ago he got sick, and we've been dealing with that. We've got him straightened out, and we're ready to do something with the property. I've got blueprints drawn up for what we're going to do to the property. We're ready to get started on it right now. If I could possibly get 60 days, you'll see a big difference in the next 60 days.
I'd be more inclined if it was 30.
You'll see a difference in 30 days, but 60, I'll have the outside completely done and windows and doors and new roof and everything on it.
Okay. Or is the board missing something? It seems to me that's reasonable, but maybe I'm missing something.
Do you have any building permits or anything?
We filed for permits last year, and we did get them. I'll have to check with them tomorrow and see if I need to get an extension on them. I don't know what our time frame is on that.
Typically, their time frame is 12 months.
Okay,
so they, depending on when you filed for them, they may be expired already.
Be closed, yeah.
So typically, even with zoning permits, it's a year, and you must start work within a year, or they just expire. So,
yeah, that's what our initial plan was. And then, like I said, my son, that we acquired that for him to move into, and then he got sick, and we dealt with that all for the past year.
We do have. I was out there today, and it doesn't appear as if anything structural has happened yet on the property. I did see two gentlemen out there. It appeared that they were landscaping in the rear yard.
Yeah, cutting grass, and then they were working on putting braces on the walls inside so we can actually put the new trusses on, take the old trusses off because of the fire damage.
Okay, so based on...
This is an image.
I'm sure I didn't miss something. Based on what's going on with the building permits and everything, are you or are you not in a position to move the needle on the property within 30 days?
Yeah, I have it going, yeah. Will it be 100% done in 30 days?
No, I'm not asking that. I just want to see noticeable improvement. This is bringing this neighborhood down.
In 30 days, yeah, I'll have noticeable change on it for sure.
We like to be reasonable on these things and not be real draconian.
And check on your permits, too. And if
I will.
Get extensions filed, if you have time to do that, too.
Well, the trusses, they're ordered. They're about a week and a half out. So I figured in that meantime, I can get the permit stuff squared away because there is permits pulled on it. I just have to get an extension on them, I'd say.
What's your budget for this project? This looks like a pretty big deal.
$80,000.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mr. Barbieri, you have any thoughts?
Yes, if it is your thought at this point to take a look in 30 days to see if there's noticeable improvement, I would suggest that we have a motion to continue this public hearing in progress so that we can come back at the next meeting.
Absolutely.
Put in additional evidence.
And we would ask you to be here too.
That's
personally,
fine.
If you could.
Yep.
Okay. I'll make such a motion.
I'll second.
Mr. Drew?
Aye.
Mr. Insko?
Aye.
Mr. Bitter?
Aye. Good luck.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Okay, let's move on to new business and public safety.
Okay, from the fire department, I request the board give consideration to hiring the 6 firefighter paramedics, career firefighter paramedics, as listed on your agenda. The candidates are currently going through their pre-employment evaluation as of right now. Starting salary for this group would be according to the department's memorandum of understanding at $43,907.76, effective Sunday, October the 9th, 2016, with a one-year probationary period.
I'll offer a motion to approve.
I'll second.
And before we take the roll, can you reiterate for everybody that's listening and watching the real necessity on the incremental career firefighters that are necessary and the relationship with the Affordable Care Act and the downstream impact that's had on part-time? Because we've talked about it before, but the 2B program was brought up again. Is if that's some black mark on us? And I think it's important for everybody to understand the entire ecosystem with firefighting. And I'm not asking you to talk about this for a half hour, but just give us a quick executive summary on why the Affordable Care Act has caused a downstream impact on housing our stations all the time.
Well, for the past 33 years, the department has utilized the combination system of staffing our firehouses. It's been a good system. Colerain was the first department in this region to initiate the part-time system. Just like the volunteer system did before, it has just gone by the wayside. You know, folks were looking for full-time jobs. And though, you know, just here recently, the Affordable Care Act has really challenged us because it's put mandates and parameters on us that limit the amount of hours that our personnel can work. We're not the only department. You know, soon after we initiated the part-time system or the combination system, just about every other department in Hamilton County and the region followed our lead. With especially the Affordable Care Act putting the limits on us that they have as far as the hours worked, it really challenged us over the past 2 years or so to staff our stations at a safe number in order for us to conduct firefighting operations and provide services to the community. So we see the need to start to supplement our daily staffing with more career people so that there's some consistency there in our staffing levels. So it's just an effort to try to meet the challenges that we deal with on a daily basis to have a adequate enough amount of staffing in the fire service and fire stations to provide the services that we do.
Thanks, Chief. I recall asking what the incremental cost is associated with hiring six career versus what we would have had to do with part-timers. I can't remember what the number was. I'd be curious that myself.
It's roughly around 18 to 20,000. The difference is, and I'll just add in the amount, the difficulty in retaining quality employees. Unfortunately, when you work for a good organization like ours and you're a part-time employee looking for full-time growth, they steal them away from us.
Yeah.
And we've lost probably 125 part-time employees over the last 5 years. To other jobs. We've lost a couple to retirement, but we've lost a lot to other. So the other costs that go in there are the training piece, the time associated with getting them ready, the equipment, the uniforms, and things like those. Those are other costs that have to be replaced when we replace new firefighters in a part-time status. But just what we learned earlier or late last week is there's two communities of Hamilton County that are eliminating the part-time workforce from their organization because of the struggles associated with finding quality people that will stay more than a year or two before going on and finding full-time employment elsewhere. So this is a real struggle, and it's been really exasperated by the Affordable Care Act.
That was a great commentary, fellas. And I think I just want everybody to understand the reality, what I'll call reality. There's been a couple of residents over the last couple of months that have talked about, oh, we've got plenty of money to reinstate the fireworks if we wanted to, and stuff like this catches up to you eventually. We just had a 20% increase on our health care cost in a single year. I support this request. It's needed to keep people safe. But between this and other cost pressures we're seeing, it catches up to you eventually. We had a very good situation going into the recession and going into the state's assault on local government to withstand it. We were able to spend down a lot of cash reserves, but that time is coming to a close soon. And so I don't want to turn this into a soapbox. I'm just saying this was a good moment to talk about yet another pressure that's, you know, on the organization to keep services up and still keep taxes at a reasonable level. That's all I'm saying. All right. Mrs. Harley, call the roll, please.
Mr. Denise?
Aye.
Mr. Ritzko?
Aye.
Mr. Bitter?
Aye.
Okay, thank you. Secondly, I'd like to request the board's approval to hire Mr. Jeff Clark for the position of full-time fleet mechanic. The board approved the creation of the position during the December 15, 2015 trustees meeting. Mr. Clark has just recently completed his pre-employment evaluations and has successfully passed those. His effective start date would be Sunday, October 9, 2016, at an annual salary of $58,000 with a one-year probationary period.
Motion to approve.
So moved.
Chair, I'll second.
Mr. Dries?
Aye.
Mr. Enzko?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye. Before we go to the next item, Mrs. Harlow, this might be a good opportunity to talk about, you know, the notion of allocating the cost of that, and does that place an unreasonable administrative burden on you? And if so, what it would be? I just want to be transparent about that and talk it through. If that's an issue.
I don't think it would place an unreasonable burden at all. I think it's one of those things that once we get it in place, it can almost be a just part of, maybe even part of the time cards or something like that. I know we do that. We know how much money, in my business, we know how much money we spent on turning over that apartment. And I can charge it to that building then. It's much the same thing. So I don't think it'll be.
Okay, I just wanted to be open about that if that was going to be an issue. Okay, keep going.
Okay, lastly, I'd like to request the board accept a donation of $5 cash received on August 15, 2016 from an anonymous donor for services provided by the fire department.
Chair, I'll make a motion to approve. Second.
Mr. Dries?
Aye.
Ms. Frenchco?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Thank you, board. Request the board's approval to approve a memorandum of understanding with the sergeant's bargaining unit. This is a uniform budgeting that will help me control the uniform costs and control some of the expenditures that go along with equipping our officers.
Chief, briefly, these next three items, or I'm sorry, the next two items that were, no, A, and then the health insurance part, too. Now, that's more of like a one culture system, right? And that's
correct.
Just to align the
Let me restate it this way. Why is this necessary tonight?
Well,
necessary because we conceded this to the fire union in their negotiations, and we're trying to be fair to the police union, who had already agreed to this concession. We're now going back, out of the goodness of our heart and out of a sense of fairness, to not place the same restriction on them.
Actually, not on this particular item. This particular item is a separate item. The item that Mr. Ritter is referring to, you're absolutely correct, and I'll address that. That's under my report.
Okay.
But this is something specifically different with regards to the uniform.
Yeah, this is for a uniform allowance to allow me to budget ahead of time of how much I'm going to spend on some of the equipment costs.
Sure, I'll make a motion to approve that.
I'll second.
Mr. Dries?
Aye.
Mr. Enzko?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Next item is a request for approval of promotion of a probationary sergeant, Jamie Penley. Jamie is the officer that is next up on the promotion list. And this is a backfill of a position. It's not a new position that's being created.
I'll make a motion. Jamie's phenomenal.
I'll second.
Mr. Dries?
Aye.
Mr. Enzko?
Aye.
Aye.
Request the board's appointment of a full-time police officer, Rachel Hayes. Rachel is currently an officer of the Hamilton County Sheriff's Office, and she has completed our hiring process, and she is on the list to be next up. And that will be a backfill again of another position that's retiring in October.
I'll make a motion to approve.
Second. Mr. Dries?
Aye.
Mr. Enzko?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
The last item is appointment of a part-time records clerk. Patrick Anakin is currently employed by St. Xavier High School and will work on weekends for us and do some days to allow us 7 days a week operation.
So what's the business case for this? In other words, is there a offset by calls diverted from the comm center, or how would you rationalize the business case for this?
That is part of the savings. We also had a full-time position previously that we took and split into two part-time positions to save us money on benefits and other issues as well. Both of those people that we appointed to that position were not any longer able to carry those hours, so those hours are still left over for us to fill. So this is still part of that replacement of a full-time position, but it does allow us to divert calls on Sunday, which we don't do at this point, and have our office open for anybody that needs police service, which increases week by week.
Excellent, thank you. The chair will offer a motion to approve.
I'll second.
Mr. Dries?
Aye.
Mr. Enzko?
Absolutely aye.
Aye.
First item, approval of a resolution authorizing the township administrator to prepare and submit an application to the OPWC, Ohio Public Works Commission. I recommend the Board of Trustees approving the resolution authorizing the township administrator to prepare and submit applications to participate in the Ohio Public Works Commission State Capital Improvement and or Local Transportation Improvement Program and to execute contracts as required.
Steve, you know my passion for grants. You can't get them if you don't try, right?
That's right.
I'll make a motion to approve.
Well, the chair will second. This is an important point to connect the dots for folks, too, that one of the benefits of the Rumpke settlement is that we now have the strategic flexibility to try to turn 1 and 1 equal to 4 and 5 by leveraging our own dollars with the SCIP program. It's just a great opportunity for us to try to stretch our dollars more and to try to address, especially, you know, neighborhoods that, quite frankly, need the nuclear button on their roads. So, anyway, this is a good move, and like I said, I'll support it.
I'd like to just point out, just to clarify, that the normal $1,250,000 that's part of the budget will continue for normal road resurfacing. What we're proposing as part of the SCIP project, if we receive it, is that we will strategically earmark part of our reserves into a debt fund, so to speak, so that we can borrow money from the state at zero interest, use that to repay it. So that'll be kind of on top of the $1,250,000. And then we'll have to evaluate how long we can keep that going, but it will be a strategic utilization of reserves.
What's the latest on Rumpke abandoning Hughes Road so we can start collecting that extra money?
Well, we're working on it. They're working on an amendment to the consent decree that may or may not take place, but that's a condition precedent to the vacation of Hoover Road. Hughes Road.
Yeah. Any guess ballpark when this?
It's moving more slowly than I thought. I was hoping we'd have it by October, November. I'm not really feeling too optimistic about that now, but we're working it through as best we can. Our zoning department is meeting with Rumpke to talk about this new building they're going to build, and that's part and parcel of this.
Perfect. Thank you.
Mr. DeVries?
Aye.
Mr. Unskill?
Aye.
Mr.
Aye.
Last item, approval of resolution to declare nuisance and ordering abatement. Recommend the Board of Trustees approving of the resolution to remove uncontrolled vegetation or refuse at the listed properties.
Make a motion to approve. Chair, I'll second.
Mr. Driggs?
Aye.
Mr. Renskill?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter, members of the board, under administration report, first I'd like to recommend approval of the fund-to-fund transfers. This is just actually following through on the transaction to transfer money from the general fund into our parks fund pursuant to what's been appropriated in order for the parks department to continue to operate.
Chair, I'll offer a motion to approve. I'll second.
Mr. Driggs?
Aye.
Mr. Renskill?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
The recommendation for the supplemental appropriations is so that we can allocate the 20% funding that we receive from Hamilton County into some supplemental road work. It's in the amount of $123,181 is the additional amount we're asking for. So the money's already been received from the county. Now we're just allocating it.
Chair, I'll make a motion to approve. I'll second.
Mr. Driggs?
Aye.
Mr. Renskill?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
The next two items do refer back to what was discussed earlier. I am recommending that we do an MOU with our police union and our sergeants union next. And basically, it's, in my opinion, it's Me Too language, but it's something that we're introducing in this era of trying to be consistent and developing a culture. Sometimes because you bargain with different bargaining units, you're not always as successful in getting everything you might desire. That's what the bargaining is all about. So as a result of that, we believe it's the right thing to do to do an MOU to address the goal plan issue with our police department so that our public safety departments are in line with regards to those medical benefits.
Unfortunately, our fire union found it unreasonably burdensome that they wouldn't acquiesce to that reasonable request in my mind to control our health care costs, but we digress. Chair, I'll make a motion to approve.
I'll second.
Mr.
Andrews?
Aye.
Mr. Renskill?
Aye.
Aye. Next item is for the sergeants. Same item.
Chair, I'll make a motion to approve.
Second.
Aye. Aye.
Then my final item is a recommendation to approve the agreement with the Colerain Historical Society with regards to the Creedville Toll Booth and Post Office as presented in your packet.
Chair, I'll offer a motion to approve.
I'll second.
Aye.
Aye.
That concludes my report.
Thank you. Mrs. Harlow.
All right. First, let's go ahead and approve the minutes of the regular meeting of August 9th, 2016.
I'll make a motion to approve. Chair, I'll second.
Mr. Driggs? Mr. Andrews?
Aye.
Mr. Insko?
Aye.
Mr. Bitter?
Aye.
And I'd like to ask for your usual approval of payroll purchase orders and receipts.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Andrews?
Aye.
Mr. Insko?
Aye.
Mr. Bitter?
Aye.
And I have a whole bunch of liquor permit transfers. And I will tell you now that I have, with all of these, I have previously spoken to Mrs. LeCount and Chief Denny, and neither of them see a need for any hearing on these, but I still need to present them to you so I can send them back to the Division of Liquor Control. First is a stock change for the Walgreens on West Galbraith, 3084 West Galbraith. The next is a stock change for the Walgreens at 2335 John Gray Road. The next is a transfer from Nine Siblings Company LLC, DBA Galbraith Food Mart at 3386 West Galbraith to Star Six Enterprises, Inc., DBA Galbraith Food Mart at the same address, and that's a transfer. The next is a stock change for Hyde's Lanes there on Cheviot Road. Good number of those, so if the board agrees, we'll go ahead and send those on back to the Division of Liquor Control with Mark that there is no hearing needed. Finally, I'd like to thank Mr. Rowan. It has been an honor and a pleasure to work with you. Most days, right? No, I'm teasing. I'm teasing, absolutely. I've learned much from you, and I appreciate the opportunity to do so. So I thank the board for their of bringing him on a few years ago. And Dan, when you were a sergeant, my dad said, hey, that lieutenant's going to go places. Yeah, that lieutenant's gone places. Thank you. It is truly an honor to work with you as well. That's all I have.
Okay, is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Chair, I'll second.
Mr. Andrews?
Aye.
Mr. Insko?
Aye.
Mr. Bitter?
Aye.
Thank you. Everybody, a great evening.